We're talking to Stanley Smith at the Traveler's Rest Church in Samson, Alabama. This is at the annual Sacred Harp Book Convention meeting. Is that the name?
The Sacred Harp Book Company.
Sacred Harp Book Company meeting. This happens once a year, and it's a business meeting and a singing at the same time. So, Stanley, how long have you sung Sacred Harp?
Let's see, since I was 12. Well, my goodness. Now, you shouldn't ask me that. I have to calculate. Okay, right at 30 years. I started when I was 12. They had a singing school there in Ozark, and I used to go to a little church near where at the old home place, call it. You could hear the singing from the house. And anyway, used to love to go over there. My daddy, you'd carry me, and they announced they were having a singing school for 2 weeks during the summer of 73. And daddy carried me to it the 2 weeks. And we learned how to sing the notes and keep time, and started bumming rides with the singers, and been going ever since.
Your father was also a singer?
No, my father was not. My grandfather, none of my family were, but my grandfather loved it. He was a good professional listener, but I never really knew him, but they told me how he loved it, and hearing it and knowing how he loved it, it was instilled in me.
Who was the teacher at that singing school?
It was Mr. Fred Botts from Troy area, who was a student of Mr. J.C. Harden, who still lives in that area. Mr. Botts died several years ago.
Mr. Harden was a student at Troy State for a bit, and he did research. One of his things as a history student was research on the Sacred Harp. Do you know much about what he did?
No, I'm sorry, I don't.
Well, he took doing all the videos and...
Oh, okay, yeah, with... Mr. Harden would go to the singers. He got a video camera and recorded every singing that he would go to. He would travel all over Southeast Alabama and Florida and North Alabama and even up to Chicago a few times recording the singings. And so he has a fabulous collection of videotapes of singings through the years, late 80s, early 90s when it started.
And he lives in Shiloh outside of Brundage?
Yes, sir. Sure does.
Now, you're a board member of the book company, is that right?
Yes, sir.
When did you be... When did you become a board member of the company?
Oh, I don't know. It's been several years ago. When we're back in the early 90s, we started work on the first of the latest revisions of the Sacred Harp. It had not been revised since 1960. And that revision was just minor, just adding very few songs. But I was put in as the revision committee editor and chairman for the 1992 revision, which what we did was put in about 33 songs, traded out some that were not used, and put in some favorites and a few by some of the current songwriters in the Sacred Harp style.
Most of the songs in the Sacred Harp are old songs, is that right?
Oh yes, they date back to some from over in England, and most from early as this country was being formed. A lot of the songs are saved that were used in camp meetings through the 1800s. And like I said, up in the New England area, when the singing school masters would come and teach their singing schools and would write songs, those songs are saved like in the Sacred Harp style, in which are not saved in most hymnals today.
When we talk about Sacred Harp, what is meant by Sacred Harp and shape note singing?
As the country was being formed, you know, a lot of the rural areas, they weren't able to lug pianos and organs around to the different communities, and so they devised, it was an American system, they devised where they put shapes with the different notes. And they used the English scale, which, you know, we're familiar with the Italian scale, the do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. The in the English scale was the same tones, but it's fa, sol, la, fa, sol, la, mi, fa. And they put a triangle to represent fa, circle to represent sol, square to represent la, and then a diamond to represent mi on the scale. So as the songs were written out in the earlier books, they were written in these shaped notes, and the singing school teachers would teach the people how to recognize the different intervals of the tones by the shapes of the notes. So they would go through and sing the notes first until they learned how the song went, and then they went back and sang the lyrics to the song to get the message from the hymn. And in the Sacred Harp, that tradition, we just keep that tradition alive of singing the notes traditionally for the first time, just to enjoy the music, and then the second, then we get the message from the words afterwards.
The original Sacred Harp was compiled by B.F. White, Benjamin Franklin White.
Mm-hmm.
And now in Alabama, there are two main Sacred Harp books that are B.F. White books, but they're different editions. And one is the Cooper book edition that you're part of, and then the other one is the Denson edition. Now, what is the difference between these two?
Back in the 1800s, 1844, Mr. B.F. White, Benjamin Franklin White, of Hamilton, Georgia, just above Columbus, he compiled the first songbook. It's actually entitled The Sacred Harp. So that's where we get the name Sacred Harp, is this book that he compiled with those older songs and then current songs of that day. It went through a few revisions during the 1800s, and back in the 1870s, after he died, there was a while where there was no revisions for the Sacred Harp. And a lot of the songs did not have an alto part to them. It was just a three-part song. And alto had become very popular with the new gospel style music that was coming along. So to help increase interest in the old Sacred Harp at the time, in the early 1900s, Mr. W.M. Cooper from Dothan worked on a revision which added a lot of alto parts, and that book, copyright 1902, came out 1903. This is the 100th year session, 100th year of the Cooper revision. He came out with his revision with these alto parts, and it was very popular throughout Southeast Alabama and Florida and Georgia. Around 1911, though, there was another revision came out up in the around the Atlanta area and up in the Northeast Alabama. They were working together. It was the James revision, which developed into the other branch for the book that's being used now. It was more in the territory where Mr. White had come from. So they didn't like the Cooper, how he revised the book. So they went and revised the old song book in their way. And
they also added altos as well.
They added alto parts, some very, you know, similar, some, you know, some different to the old songs. But as time went along, the different geographic areas used the different books. Like in South Alabama's strictly Cooper book, where Northern Alabama is the line of the James book, which was later revised by the Denson brothers, and then later they come out with a 1991 edition.
Who wrote the new songs in the book?
We have in the Cooper revision, we have some new. We have a few songwriters around who have put some songs in the book. It's I've got a few in there, and then we have John Merritt, who originally lived around Stapleton, Alabama, near Bay Minette at the time. He lives over in Oxford, Mississippi now.
This is the brand new revision.
The 1992 revision.
1992
revision. Yes, and. Also, we have a man in, two men in Texas have songs in the book. Elder Robert Vaughn and also Herbert Leopard, who has died just a few years ago. But you were talking about that was the 1992 revision of the Cooper revision. We did come out with one more edition in 2000, which it was not any new songs, but it was some of the songs from the old plates from back in 1902, they were lead plates and there were some typographical errors. So in the 2000, several of the pages that had some major typesetting problems, we addressed those.
What songs did you write in the book?
There's a song entitled Chicago, which is dedicated to the Midwest Sacred Harp singers. There's one, San Diego, which is for in honor of those people and singers in San Diego. One called Texas, in honor of the Texas singers. And one called Hall Ridge, which is named for a community over in East Coffee County, West Dale County, where Mr. Cooper originally came from. I know those are strange titles for songs, but in the Sacred Harp book, a lot of the songs aren't like in a normal hymnal. They're usually the title, and other hymnals are just the first line, first few words of the song, but these are actually the tune. The tune names, so you could recognize that tune no matter what words you might substitute for a song. You can still use, you know, that's just the name for the tune.
And you wrote the tune?
Yes, sir.
And the words came from?
The words came for those or from the Lloyd Hymn Book, which is a little booklet that has it does not have musical notation in it. It's just the verses written in poetic form. And there's used a lot in the Primitive Baptist churches. But there were some words that touching. The Lord touched me with those and revealed the tune to me, and we just got it wrote down.
And these words were probably written in the
1700s, like Charles Wesley and Isaac Watts, those type writers.
What is your favorite song to lead?
It's just according to what the mood is at the time. I cannot say I have a favorite or favorite to lead. There's just it's like a buffet, you know. There's all of it's good, so. I can't say I have a favorite, but it just, the one thing about with the Sacred Harp, there's something in there for whatever your soul needs at the time. And you can feel, you know, definitely find find what the Lord touched you with it in the book when it comes time to lead.
Well, thank you very much for talking to us today.
You're welcome.
It.
Thank you, sir.